It is a joy and a privilege tonight to introduce to you, although most obviously he needs no introduction in a space like this, Sean Dietrich. And several people have asked me, how did you get Sean to come? And I said, I asked him. And he said, sure. When? I said, well, how about May 10th? Okay. That was it. That was the extent of the planning and organization that went into getting the two of us together here tonight. And I am pleased that you have all come out to hear him. I discovered Sean's writing probably November, December, and consumed it because it's wonderful stuff. And it speaks to the heart of what I believe as a Christian pastor and leader and teacher and as a Southern person from Mississippi. And I realize that Mississippi and Alabama are not the same. There's just kind of a weird mirror image going on there. But the words that he speaks, the words that he writes, speak to the heart of what it is to be a part of this strange and marvelous community of the South and of the human race. Thank you for coming, Sean. And I'm going to turn it over to you.
Can everybody hear me all right? Mic on. How about now? Can everybody hear me now? Woo, all right. Well, as you can tell, I'm not really much of a speaker. You know, I've grown up in church my whole life, but speaking is quite a different thing. The first time I really spoke was at a funeral. Now, I grew up with a friend named Adam, and there was a woman named Myrtis who raised him. Adam lived on the bayou on the Choctahatchee Bay, and Myrtis was his aunt and had taken over raising Adam when his parents had passed. We would fish the bayou and the canals that led to the bayou, and Miss Myrtis would stand on her porch right around the end of the day, and she would say, "Hey, Adam!" Man, these are great acoustics. A fella could get used to this. Adam and I would come in, and we would find Miss Myrtis sitting on her porch, and she would have lunch ready for us, or late lunch. It would be cheese sandwiches cut into quarters. We would eat. She was old. She would tell us stories about the old days growing up around the Choctahatchee Bay and about running barefoot through the pine straw and the Cahaba lilies. About getting the ground itch. Does anybody know what ground itch is? Most people with white in their hair do. And I'd say, "Miss Myrtis, what's ground itch?" And she'd say, "Well, you know what hookie is?" I'd say, "I reckon I do." She'd say, "If you step in hookie and you're barefoot, you'll probably get the ground itch." I loved Miss Myrtis, and I loved her stories. Often we would drive in the car and she would sing this song, "Give Me the Old Time Religion." Adam didn't like that much. He'd ask her to stop, but she'd keep singing. She'd just rub it into him. "Give me that old time religion." So when I heard at church that she had died, it broke my heart. I went to little service and the pastor got up on stage and he said, "We're not going to have a send-off message. I'm not going to give a final eulogy. It's going to be you who gives the eulogy." So immediately, Mrs. Myrtis' friends made a line that went back for a little ways. We heard all these wonderful words about Miss Myrtis, how she grew up, what she'd gone through. I waited my turn, and finally, for my debut for speaking in front of a room of people, I took the microphone and I stood on a stage a lot like this, and I told stories about Miss Myrtis, and about fishing the canals, about her singing in the car, about cheese sandwiches cut into quarters. While I spoke, there was a projector in the rear of the room. It was blazing photographs of a young woman on a big white screen behind me. It was Miss Mertes. And I turned around while I spoke such beautiful words that never poured from my mouth. And I realized I had never seen that woman before in my life. So what does any male do when he finds himself deep in a pile of hookie? He just keeps talking. So I just kept telling stories and talking about Miss Mertes, the one that I knew. And when I was done, I got off the stage, and I had been up there for about 10 minutes. And there was an old gentleman right here, and he shook my hand, and he said, "I'm Miss Mertes' husband. Who in the H-E-double-Q are you?" And I said, "Well, you might not know me, sir, but Miss Mertes was a beacon to many." And thus began my career of speaking to crowds. The next week at church, a few friends of mine, we'd gathered in the back, and we had waited by the door. We saw a little old woman crawl out of a Cadillac. She was wearing pink. She came running to the front door, and my friend Donald ran off the steps, and he hugged her, and he said, "Miss Mertes, you're alive." We went over to her house afterwards, and we just took turns staring at her. So needless to say, speaking has never been something I thought would be in my future. But it hasn't worked out that way. I was not somebody who you would expect much out of in life. My mother would probably tell you that if you got her in a private setting. If she had to stand up here on the stage, she'd say, "Well, I knew that boy would do something with his life." But if you talked to her in private, she'd say, "Well, Sean struggled." And that's true. I was not a very good student. I failed the fifth grade. This was a very traumatic experience in my life. My teacher was named Mrs. Bruner. She had tall hair, like a beehive hairdo. She wore a long skirt, and she wore these very, very modest tops. And she was a holiness preacher's wife. She taught the fifth grade with an iron fist, and that woman never liked me, not one day in her life. We used to study things, and she would talk in such a way to me as though I were 3 years old. She would talk down to me, and I would give these answers to her, and no matter what answer I would give her, it would sound as though I were a 35-pound dumbbell. She'd say, "Do you know who fought the Battle of Waterloo?" And I'd say, "Well, I don't know." I wasn't very good at scholastics. She told me once, when I had given her a journal of writings that I had done, that I didn't really have a whole lot of talent, and it crushed me as a child. I kept a small journal, a Red Indian Chief journal, written with a number one pencil, of these stories about the high seas and shameless women, the Old West. I presented it to her one day. I don't know what I was thinking. Holiness preacher reading stories about the high seas and shameless women. She read through it and she said, "I don't know how to tell you this, but you use too many commas. Every other word is the word suddenly. I don't think you're going to be a writer. I think you have a promising career in construction work." Hand to God, my fifth grade teacher told me I had a promising career in construction work. My father was a blue-collar worker. I come from a long line of blue-collars. So this wounded me as a fifth grader. Years later, I understand they let that poor woman go. And years later, for some reason, I am writing. It wasn't too long ago that I was wandering through a Piggly Wiggly, and I was wandering through the checkout aisle. I had a package of beef jerky and a block of Swiss cheese. I don't know why I remember that. I set my items on the little conveyor belt, and when it was time to ring them up, I saw a woman behind the counter with a beehive hairdo. She was wearing a red apron, and I'd never been so happy to see her in that red apron for a living. She said, "Sean, it's you." I said, "Yes, it is." She gave me a hug, and we talked. And I realized that she was just a woman who was doing the best she could with her life, just like I was, trying to earn a few pennies to rub together. She asked me what I did for a living. At the time, I worked construction. I bid her farewell, and I have never seen or heard from her again. But after failing the fifth grade, I believed it was over for me. Fifth grade is a very formative year. It's a year where you're not quite a child anymore. You're just about to become a teenager. You don't really know the difference between the two, but you know just something don't feel right. So I was very impressionable. By sixth grade, I was crushed because she had failed me. My mother took this as a personal offense. She marched me into a sixth grade classroom on the other side of town, another school, and she demanded that we speak with the principal. It was summertime. We walked in, and I was dressed in my Sunday best with a necktie. I looked like a fool. She went to the principal and she said, "I want my son to be in the sixth grade." She said, "Well, he failed the fifth grade. We're going to have to figure out why that was." She looked at me and she said, "Why do you think you failed the fifth grade?" I said, "I had a really bad teacher." She said, "Okay, let's just say that it was a personality conflict. What do you think it was? Where can you find a moment on your timeline with this holiness preacher woman where you did not connect, where the division happened?" I said, "Absolutely." I handed her my book. She said I wasn't good enough to be a writer. She said, okay. She brought out the sixth grade teacher, Mrs. Dirksen. She also had a beehive hairdo. So I was gun shy. But Mrs. Dirksen was a beautiful woman, beautiful inside. She said, "You want to be a writer, huh?" I said, "Yes, ma'am, I do." She said, "Well, bring me some of your things. I'd like to read them." So I brought her the same book that had too many commas and too many suddenlies in it. She read through it and she said, "This is good stuff. Sure, there's small technical things that we could take care of, but I think you're on your way to becoming a writer." My heart sang. She said, "I have an idea. At the beginning of every day, I would like for you to write me 100 words on a sheet of notebook paper. A story of anything you can think of, true or not true. I want you to turn it into me, and I will grade the grammar on this story. We do this every day, and you'll be amazed at what you learn." So I did. I'd show up to school, and while my other friends were talking about the game, or Lord knows what sixth graders talk about, I would write 100 words, and I would hand it to her on a half sheet of notebook paper, and she would, before class would start, she'd bring out her red pen, and she'd look through it, and she'd mark it. The first story I wrote was marked with red from top to bottom. She plastered it on her bulletin board wall. The next morning, top to bottom, red ink. She plastered that right above the next one. And it went on and on like this for an entire school year. By the end of the year, this side of the wall where my final story was posted, there was hardly any red ink on it. On the last day of class, she took them off her wall and she handed them to me and she patted me on the back. And she said, "Congratulations, Sean. You're a writer now." And that was the beginning of my, if you want to call it a career. Obviously, I've dabbled in construction. Seventh grade became the worst year of my life. My father committed suicide when I was 12. I'll never forget seeing my childhood pastor, Brother Tom, seated on our fireplace, our den. My mother said, "I'd like you to come in here. I have something to tell you with Brother Tom." I walked into our den, and there were all sorts of people sitting around on the sofas. I knew something was wrong. Brother Tom was fidgeting with his hands. I noticed he was sweating a little bit. Funny to think, Brother Tom is about the same age I am now, when a 12-year-old boy sat before him. He said, "I don't know how to tell you this. I've been awake all night. But your father took his own life with his hunting rifle." My first reaction was to go for the door. So I did. I can't explain why. I shot up to my feet and I ran toward the door. About four people held me back. I said no at the loudest volume I could. I don't know why that word, as if those two letters can change anything, no. But I said no, no. And I collapsed by the front door. And a whole team of people gathered around me. I've never felt so silly in all my life. It was as if my body was detached from my soul, and I was floating above myself, and I saw this kid wailing on the floor like an idiot. That year became the singular most defining year of my entire life, the most defining year of my mother's life, the most defining year of my little sister's life. We lived on a farm. There was a lot of work to be done. We raised chickens. We raised goats. Responsibilities fell to me. By eighth grade, I had pulled out of school altogether. We lived in an area where the school bus did not come. It required a drive into town. And my mother had begun to degenerate in her mental facilities that year. She was having a very, very hard time. She spent most days in her room. So the care of my sister fell to me. I cooked her bacon because that was about all I knew how to make. So we gained a lot of weight. I missed 8th grade, I missed 9th grade. I missed 10th grade, I missed 11th grade. I missed 12th grade. And so here I am working construction. My mother and I pieced together our income through menial jobs. She has worked in Chick-fil-A. She's catered. Her and I have cleaned condos together. We've done some pretty low things. Of course, one of our greatest jobs together was throwing the newspaper. My mother and I would wake up at 3 every morning and deliver the newspaper to half of Northwest Florida. Now, that might not sound like much, but we would pull into West Marine, which is a big marine store. I know you don't have a whole lot of water around here. We do in Northwest Florida. And they would deliver a pallet of newspapers about the size of that piano. And my mother and I would sit in a rusty Nissan, and we would take these newspapers, which were flat, and we would roll them up and put a rubber band around them, because this is before the days, I guess, of sliding them in paper, plastic sleeves. We would drive these papers all around town in these figure eight circles, which were enough to make you sick to your stomach, and we would deliver. And it was godless work, and we'd finish around 8:30 or 9. We did this on December the 13th, which is my mother's birthday. And when we had finished delivering papers to the area, restocking the paper machines, delivering to high-rise condos on the beach, delivering to double wides, my mother flipped open the newspaper and she ate a donut while we were in the front seat of her car parked in front of a Winn-Dixie. She said, "I think you're supposed to be a writer." I said, "Mama, why would you say something like that?" She said, "No, I'm reading this in the paper right now. This fella, he writes to people every day. I think you could do this." I said, "Nah, Mom, that, thank you, but no, you know me. Failed the fifth grade, haven't been to school." She started to cry. She said, "Listen to me. One day, you're going to write. And one day I want you to promise me that you're going to tell our story. And when you tell it, maybe you can make it beautiful. Like there's some reason to it all." I said, "Yes, ma'am. One day I will." The first story I ever had published was called "A FEMA Trailer for Mama." It was about the time that my mother filed bankruptcy and I drove to New Orleans to buy her a FEMA trailer to live in. It was written as a satirical piece, which is something I like to do. It's a way to process grief. The first girl who ever told me I was funny was a girl I liked very much. She said, "You know, you're a funny boy." I said, "Funny haha or funny sexy?" She said, "Funny haha." So you're telling me I have something to work with here. I wrote FEMA Trailer for Mama. She was still living in a FEMA trailer at the time. It's a little white, ugly trailer, the ugliest thing you ever seen in your life. Out back, she had tires embedded in the ground that she used as her garden. My mother had gardened all her life. She had tomato plants sprouting from the middle. On these tomato plants, she uses an ancient remedy that my granddaddy and my granddaddy's granddaddy and my granddaddy's granddaddy used, which is red man chewing tobacco and water. It's an insecticide that's natural. If you visit her trailer in the midday, you could see squirrels reclining in the trees spitting. Because the squirrels and my mother did vigilant battle toward her tomatoes. I showed her my story, FEMA Trailer for Mama. I said, "Mama, I got something published. It's my first one. That's about you." She said, "Can I have this?" I said, "Yes, ma'am." She took it into her trailer bedroom, if you can call it that. It's just a queen-size bed shoved in the back of a travel trailer. And she placed it in a frame next to a small picture of a boy who's much too young to be having a beard, who's standing in a tuxedo with his arm around a 5'2" little woman who's looking upward at him, a woman who makes exceptional biscuits, a woman who makes and grows wonderful tomatoes. And so now you know a little bit about how I've started as a writer. Because this shouldn't be happening to me. I consider myself as somebody who doesn't have a whole lot to say, with the exception being that I am a talker. This I have inherited from a long line of people in my family who do not know when to shut up. I have written 8 books, and I never thought that this this would ever be something that comes out of my mouth. It's all accidental. You're here tonight, I guess, because of something you read of mine. The feeling of humility that comes over me when I saw this room, which I thought there would only be about 5 or 6 people here, is overwhelming. That being said, I'd like to read you a few things I wrote, because Mother's Day is coming up, and mothers are my favorite topic. I don't feel comfortable standing on this big, tall... First, I'd like to read you a few things about mothers. Like I said, not being a speaker, the very best advice I ever got was from an old man preacher named Jether, who preached at a community in South Georgia. He was in a wheelchair when I talked to him. I said, I've got all these things on my calendar where people want to hear me talk. Do you have any advice that you could give someone like me about speaking to an audience? He held up one finger. He said, make sure you pee before you speak. You'll be glad to know I've taken care of business tonight. I'd like to read you something called American Mama. And I will say this ahead of time. When I'm finished reading, it helps if you clap. This isn't for my vainglory, but this is just simply to punctuate the story. It's kind of like a final period, if you will. You'll know when I look up that it's time. There is a television in the corner of this breakfast restaurant. It's broadcasting a political talk show, and the TV hosts are flinging their hands at one another, arguing about God knows what, while I try to eat my eggs. No, 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 says the talking head. Don't tell me I'm un-American, sir. You're un-American. While we watch this stuff on the television, in the booth ahead of me is a young boy, 5 years old, 6 maybe. He orders cheese, scrambled eggs. I know this because he shouts his order, which draws many looks in the restaurant. Some children's voices are shrill when they shout, but not his. It sounds like a laugh fit for the playground. His mother hushes him. He is your typical American kid, cheery face, large ears, hair poking out beneath a baseball cap, freckles. He has a big bandage over his collarbone. He coughs. Sounds like a bad cold. He uses his hat to cover his mouth. When he pulls his hat off, a small wig falls off, and I see that he is bald. I see blue veins underneath his pure scalp. The TV host on the television says, don't you tell me I'm an American, sir. I'm as American as... But I don't hear what the TV host is saying anymore because I'm listening to the boy who asks his mother, are you tired, Mama? She smiles and she nods. He says, are you as hungry as me? Because nobody's as hungry as me. She doesn't answer. She's pretty. She's young, but she's weathered. She looks like she's lived the life twice of what her peers have lived. He leans on her shoulder, and there's a medical bracelet around his wrist. He tells her, I'm sorry, Mama. I'm sorry for being so sick. Her face swells, and she says, don't you ever say that again, you hear me? Never. Meanwhile, television behind me says, I'm un-American. No, you're un-American. You. The two talking heads are really going at it. And while they do, the boy is asking his mother if he has to go back to the emergency room again. He says, I hate it there. Please don't make me go back. She shakes her head. She says, I just don't know, Trey. We'll have to see. Trey. It's a sturdy name, and he must be a strong kid because he has a strong mama. Life for some five-year-olds is carefree, but I don't get the feeling that Trey's is. The TV blares in the background something about being un-American versus who is American. Their food arrives, and they pray over it. And though I can't hear what they're whispering, I say a quiet amen along with them. The boy eats like there's no tomorrow, and he barely touches anything on his plate. When they finish, she gathers her things and pays the waitress. He walks toward the restrooms, and he doesn't move very fast. She waits for him. She shuts her eyes, and she pinches the bridge of her nose. I can tell it's been a long night. They leave, and I watch them through the window. She lifts him into his car seat. He's weak. I guess he can't do it himself. And while I watch them, the television behind me is just blaring political talk. Their car exits the parking lot, and the waitress finally shuts off that godforsaken television. And I've lost my appetite because I am too busy thinking. Dear Lord, I know you don't hear from me as often as either of us would like, but I hope you hear me today. Please help Trey. I'm begging you. You can clap now. I appreciate that. Somebody once interviewed me, and I don't know why they'd want to interview somebody like me, for the Mobile Press Register, and she said, tell me in a few words about what it is that you like to write about. I said, well, I think I can tell you in one word. Underdogs. You'll have to pardon me for messing with my hair tonight. I got a really bad haircut. My wife said, why did you go to a place where they only charge you $8 for a haircut? I said, so that I had enough to take you out tonight. She said, you don't ever write about anything famous. The woman from the press register said, I said, no, ma'am, because I don't have the qualifications. But I do have the qualifications to write about every man, because I am one. And I like underdogs. I like people who struggle. Thus, if there's one objective to whatever you call this strange career of mine, I want to write about the underdogs. And here's a story. Goes along with that topic. She was shouting in a general store. She was hollering until her voice broke, and back in those days, women did not holler. It was a small store, and it was a tiny town. It was the kind of market where the cashiers knew your name, and they asked about your mama. The screaming lady waved her finger at the man in the necktie. She was dressed in rags, and she had wiry auburn hair, sad eyes, and rough hands, three kids with her, filthy kids. The owner asked the woman to lower her voice, but the woman would not. She could not. This was a Great Depression. The only thing she had left was a voice. Her children hadn't eaten in 2 days. Her eldest boy was beginning to lose his hair in clumps. The store owner had no charity. He was new in town. He didn't know her from Adam's house cat, nor did he care for a woman who would shout in the middle of a general store. She told him how the previous store owner used to take care of her. He used to let our family charge groceries on an account, she said. On the first of every month, I put my money toward the bill. The owner said, well, it was never enough because I can see on the ledger your outstanding balance. She screamed. She told him she had no husband. She told him how she took in wash for a pittance. She pleaded for a can of beans or for some salt pork or even a few tin cans of hard biscuits. The new shop owner was fresh out of pity. He was a businessman. The only things he knew about women like her were what he saw in that ledger book. He removed the food from her basket by force, and the kids wailed. So she slapped him. He kicked her out, and he warned her not to come back to the store until she settled her debt, and then he called the sheriff. But there was no need for a sheriff. She left in tears. For supper that evening, the kids had water and hollow tummies. The oldest boy later recounted that he was so hungry he felt drunk. The world was spinning for no reason, and sometimes he just would bust into laughter, and then he'd cry. The next morning, the family awoke to loud noises on the porch. The woman walked downstairs, and she flung open the screen door. People. She saw people. They stood on her doorstep with caged chickens, sacks of flour, pinto beans, rice, butter, milk, hams. They say all the woman could do was blink. Folks took turns embracing her. The sheriff was there. The sheriff offered her a tin biscuit box. It was filled with money. He explained how several neighbors had taken up a collection, how even he himself had gone knocking on doors, asking for food, for money. In the end, they didn't raise much, but it was enough to cover a grocery debt. She told the people, "I don't want no damned charity," because this is the kind of woman she was, and poor folks are like that. He told her, "It ain't charity. We love you. Because Methodists are like that." She accepted the box. And many, many years later, my granddaddy gave that box to me. Thank you. Last week was Teachers Appreciation Week. Raise your hand if you are a teacher, or were a teacher, or know a teacher. I have a tender spot in my heart for teachers, almost as tender as I have for my mother-in-law. My mother-in-law is in failing health. We have moved in with her. It's been the most challenging thing of my life. But we get along, me and Miss Mary, which is her name. But I call her Mother Mary. I've always called her Mother Mary. It's an understanding between us. I'd like to read you something about Mother Mary. My mother-in-law fell yesterday. She stumbled in the garage, and it was bad. She smacked her face on the pavement. She busted her glasses and her nose. When I found her, she was bleeding. "We're going to the ER," I said. "I feel lightheaded," remarked the Scarlett O'Hara lookalike. "Yes, ma'am, take my arm." "Wait, I need to brush my teeth." "But ma'am, you're bleeding all over. These shoes don't match my belt. Get my blue shoes from the closet quick." "No, no, not those, the slingback heels." "But ma'am, it doesn't look so good for you right now. Get my lipstick." "I can't die without my lipstick." "Please, ma'am, take my arm. It's time to go. Oh, where are my pearls?" I've never left the house without my pearls. Meet Mother Mary. I have called her that ever since our very first supper together, and that was a long time ago. I remember the meal, rump roast, served with enough trimmings to make the table buckle. For dessert, we had pear salad, half a pear topped with mayonnaise, shredded cheese, and one cherry. Now, I ate every bite, but you should know I would rather lick a possum than eat pear salad. You can imagine what her face looked like when I nearly gagged while I ate one cup of mayonnaise. Even so, that was the night that Mother Mary and I discovered we liked each other. She told me to call her that, Mother Mary, and it's all I've ever called her. For she was my mother-in-law, I visited once to take her daughter on a movie date. Her husband, a rowdy man, answered the front door with 12-gauge. He said, Jamie is upstairs, but her mama and I are on the pier fishing. I said, with a 12-gauge. Her daddy led me to where Mother Mary was. She was working a rod and reel on the dock, and she started screaming, I got one, I got one. And without saying a word, my wife's daddy aimed the double barrel at the fish and gave it holy hell. It was a speckled trout about the size of a man's grown leg, and I can understand why he would need a shotgun. A woman as frail as Mother Mary could not fight such a fish. That night, we canceled our movie date, and we ate with my wife's parents, fried fish, hush puppies, french fries, okra, and anything else her daddy could stuff into a deep fryer. I am hard-pressed to remember having a better time. And if I didn't know any better, I would have sworn these people cared about me. Then, Mother Mary brought out more pear salad. Anyway, after our ER visit today, Mother Mary sat in a recliner with a bandaged face. Her wrist is purple, and her face is swollen, and she is very tired. But she is also tough. This Bellevue Avenue Belle grew up in a time of cotton dresses and bare feet to school, and a time of decency. She has survived a handful of dear friends, 13 U.S. presidents, and one late husband who liked to fish with firearms. Mother Mary has one titanium hip, crippling rheumatism, and an accent that sounds just like Azalea's. She brings Bruton, Alabama into any room she enters, and anyone fortunate enough to hear her say at least three words ends up smiling. She can arrange flowers, paint with oils. She can write thank yous until dawn, and has. She can sing any Hank Williams tune. She also likes the Beach Boys. The doctors did CAT scans, x-rays, and other tests. The young physician remarked that he'd never seen a patient with cleaner teeth or nicer lipstick. That poor physician, he didn't even mention her pearls. I broke my glasses falling, she told me, while she covered her bruised face. They were real expensive. No, ma'am. Glasses are cheap. But there will never be another Mary Finley Martin. One of my mother-in-law's favorite things is when I write about her. She's unashamedly vain. But it is Mother's Day coming up. And so I will speak this Mother's Day at the church she grew up in Bruton, Alabama. And this is a very big deal. I'll stand on a stage a lot like this, and I'll tell jokes that will humiliate her, like I did tonight. But I'm very, very glad to be a part of her family. after the life I had growing up, my wife's family embraced me and has become my widow into what you would call a seemingly normal life. I'm very grateful to my in-laws. My in-laws, in many ways, are, I like to say, when I met my wife, it was like being born again. Thus, I was raised by women. I have a very tender spot in my heart toward the fair sex. And I like to write about women a lot because it's very hard to be a woman in today's society. It's a lot harder, I believe, to be a woman than it is a man. But I have no real experience in this field. There are women to my left, women to my right. Pastel colors everywhere. There's enough conflicting perfume scents to make my head swim. This could be the largest female gathering on planet Earth, and I am in their hotel lobby. If you want to know what I'm talking about, visit Atlanta, Georgia during a Mary Kay convention. You will see women of every shape, size, hair color, and you will hear too many southern accents to count, such as the 80-year-old woman next to me who sits eating a lukewarm complimentary breakfast. Her daughters are with her and her granddaughters too. "We are from Marietta," she says, but she doesn't say Marietta, she says Maretta. Then she insists on shaking my hand. Like this, Mama extends her wrist, kind of like the Queen of England does before she blesses a NASCAR race. Anyway, I'm not sorry about my strong affections for the women of Dixie. No, sir. There is something special about them, and I will die believing that. They are well-behaved women, unpredictable. Using only one breath, they can cuss you blind, and they can turn around and preach a full-blown sermon. Sometimes they do both at once, and they do it with such charm that you end up thanking them for it. They dress to the nines, often spending upwards of 6 hours before a bathroom mirror, like the lady I saw in the lobby wearing 10-inch heels, a puff pink suit, 14 feet of hairspray. It must have taken her a week to get ready. The young girl in the hoop skirt and bonnet, her, for instance, it took 3 grown men to get her out of the hotel elevator. but my tenderness for these females runs deep. This might have to do with the food they make. They can whip up cornbread or crank out biscuits or deep fry 100 chicken livers before you've even brushed your teeth. They're not ashamed to eat what they make, like they are in big cities. And by God, they don't expect you to be either. And I proved that just over there tonight. They are short, tall, round, skinny, well-bred, and just a little red. They can convert church bulletins into hand fans. They can take sermon notes on an old envelope, and they won't hesitate to tan the hide of a sass mouth even if he's in his 40s. She'll watch football. She will out-scream you at a tailgate party. She will open beer bottles with car keys, and she will stink up your house with a fresh pot of collards. She's a single mother, a widow, a full-time employee, a craftswoman, a house cleaner, a church lady, a Cracker Jack bridge player, a bedmaker, and a Mary Kay sales associate. She can pay her own taxes, cut her own grass, train your coon hound, sew her own clothes, hold Bible study in her living room, and throw one hell of a baby shower. She is confection sugar on the outside, 100% black powder underneath. Take a good look at her. This isn't the perfect woman. She's even better than that. She's my wife. One of the things that I did not expect when I started to write was the way religion and faith has creeped into what I write. I have never considered myself very religious, though I have worked in 3 churches. I've never considered myself as somebody with anything to say about religion. Of course, it could be argued that I don't really talk about religion. I talk more about certain beliefs I have, and these beliefs are within the culture that we find ourselves in. There are such beautiful things within our culture, especially in the South, especially related to the Bible Belt, that are part of who I am. And even if I don't believe some of these things, I find myself identifying with my ancestors and why they chose to do certain things. I spent 1 Sunday in a snake handling church with my cousin. Midway through the service, they brought up a little aquarium of snakes, and one of my most deathly fears is a snake. When I was in the 1st grade, they brought out a python from the zoo, and they walked it around to different people, and when they got to me, there was a puddle on the floor. So my cousin says, "Why don't you go up there and handle a snake?" I said, "Why don't you go up there and handle a snake?" My cousin did, because this is the culture he knew. He walked up to the stage, and an old man brought the snake out of the aquarium, and he handed it to my cousin. And my cousin reached his hands out, and he held the snake, and he looked at the man, and he said, "Now what am I supposed to do?" He said, "Squeeze him." So he squeezed him. While he did that, the snake started going crazy. The old woman beside me said, "Don't worry, they've taken all the fangs out of these things." Thus, I've decided to write about these sorts of things, because this is unique. And for some reason, that demonstrates faith to certain people, and I like it. So I'm going to read you a few things I've written about religion since we are in a church. This is called My Hope for You. I'll say it like this. I hope you get a bowl of ice cream today. Not just ice cream, but peach cobbler, hot from the oven. And may you eat the two together by enjoying the pleasant, albeit unique, sensation of hot and cold at once in your mouth. That's what I wish. Also, I hope you feel filthy rich today. Not rich in money, per se, but you get the idea. Kind of like leaning back in a lawn chair and enjoying easiness when everything seems simpler than it should be. Kind of like when everything seems to be going right. Like skipping rope on the moon, or hitting home runs with a tennis ball, fishing in a fishbowl, or playing the game Operation without batteries. Today, I hope a dog stares at you with big eyes that seem to say, "Pet me." And I hope you give in, because dogs don't do this for themselves. I hope you see something big today, something very big. And by big, I mean something vast, like a field or an ocean or a clear sky or a Dairy Queen. I hope it overwhelms you just for a moment. I hope it's the kind of feeling that makes you think about things that are more important than bank accounts. Last night I stood on the beach at midnight. I hadn't done that in years. The dark water seemed to go on for billions of miles. It was as though I stood only inches away from the doorstep of heaven itself. "Sean," I imagined the Almighty would say, answering his front door, "hath thou happened to bringeth thee any ice cream?" And there I'd stand dumbfounded before the Creator of heaven and earth, and I would sayeth, "You betteth I did." Because thouest never visits heaven without bringing a carton of ice cream. And when I am finished, I hope I will come away with a blessing. That can be arranged, Sean. So what do I hope for you? I hope your email quits today. I hope your phone dies, and I hope the internet goes out. And I hope you enjoy it. I hope you get a handwritten letter from someone you haven't heard from in decades. There's something about a handwritten letter that speaks. I wish you the sensation of winning a baseball game, the kind of feeling when everyone rushes the field and dogpiles with their pals. That's quite a feeling. I hope for some reason you reach the verge of happy crying and then start laughing, just like a hormonal woman does. I hope you're fortunate enough to lay in bed with someone you love, and if not with someone you love, with a God who is there, who is real, who you can talk about things that you've never thought about before, who you can ask questions. I pray the sky puts on a colorful sunset for you tonight. I guess what I'm trying to say is, I love you, no matter who you are. And I really hope you get a bowl of ice cream. I'm going to read one more for you. And this is something that I really enjoy, if I can find it. I began writing what I called good stories. It started during the election season. I told myself I wouldn't say those words. I'm like anybody. On Facebook, I would see things that would just turn my stomach, both sides. And I felt that good things were being neglected. And I wrote one, the only viral thing I ever had. And it was just entitled Good. I don't make any money off those. I don't want to make any money off those. What I want is for people like me, like you, to know that this world isn't going to the dogs. So, I have written these things, which are small news snippets that come to me from a lot of people. A lot of them are things I've seen. I have too many of them. I write them too often because some of them move me. They come into my inbox by the thousands, and there's no way I could possibly write them all. But I do try to write what I can. And this is one that I wrote. New Orleans, Louisiana. I once saw a teenage boy as lean as a 2x4 tap dancing on a sheet of cardboard. His brother beat a plastic bucket with drumsticks. The percussion got faster, and so did the kid's feet. And before long, 50 spectators had gathered. The kid danced until he broke a sweat. For his big finish, so help me, the kid did a backflip. I found myself applauding and carrying on. When the boys finished, all they'd earned were $7 in tips, and I know this because $5 in that box came from me. The disappointed young dancer swallowed his pride. He tipped his hat, and he said, God bless y'all. God bless y'all big. And he looked like he meant it. Chipley, Florida, a Piggly Wiggly. A young girl and her boyfriend stood ahead of me in line, her with a baby on her hip, him covered in sawdust. On the conveyor belt, basic groceries, baby food, diapers, formula. The skinny boy reached into his pocket to pay, and when he did, the manager came over and whispered into the young man's ear, and then he winked at him. The kid put his wallet away, and with sincerity, he said, "God bless you, sir." And they left with a full buggy. Mobile, Alabama. My truck broke down. It was raining. And during the dark ages, before cell phones, to be stranded meant being stranded. 4 Mexican construction workers approached me. One of them was a mechanic. What are the odds? He fixed my truck right there. I reached into my wallet and I tried to pay him. He refused. I wish I knew what he said. He slammed my hood shut. He shook my hand and he left me with a "God bless you, my friend." He said it with such a thick accent, I just about missed it. Not that it matters what I think. Turn on your television. Selfishness is for sale, and it's selling at clearance prices. But to those of you who tap dance, who leave big tips, who compliment others, who like to kiss dogs right on the jowls, who like to be the fella who buys lunch, who fix cars for strangers even when you don't speak their language, who gives hugs, who listens, who cries more often than they like to admit, or to anyone who can fog up a mirror, God bless you. Thank you for having me tonight. It's been a lot of fun.